All right.
We are live. Welcome to the Lovecraft eZine Sunday show. Today is Sunday, November the 2nd, 2014. And welcome. Thanks for watching. Today we have Les Klinger, author of the new Annotated H.P. Lovecraft. And he annotated some Sherlock Holmes books, which I'm a fan of Sherlock Holmes, and I've not seen these, so I really have to check them out. And as usual, we have Joe Pulver and Rick and Pete on the show today. I think Matthew Carpenter is joining us, and Bill, but I'm not sure. And towards the end of the show, everyone that's watching, Niels Hobbs is going to join us, the guy that's in charge of Necronomicon, so maybe we'll hear some news about that. So anyway, Les, I really appreciate you coming on the show. This is a
my pleasure.
This is a really wonderful book. It really is.
Thank you. I see that you're holding up the ARC.
Yes.
Have you seen the actual published version?
No, I haven't.
Well, the difference is color, and I am really, really excited about the quantity of color that appears in the final product.
Is that what you just told us?
Gorgeous book.
Okay. Oh man, I gotta get one. There's also a Kindle version, which
yes.
Some people might sneer at a Kindle version of something like this. But the fact is, Kindle's great because it's searchable. It's great to have a Kindle version.
Absolutely. There are two great benefits to using the e-version of it. One is the searchability, which for a book without an index is useful. The second is that you can blow up the pictures by looking at it on an iPad or one of those with a touch screen, and sort of the pictures were scanned in really high resolution, so it's a great way to appreciate the pictures in the e-version. But you need both, of course.
Yes. Well, I have a lot of books that I can afford in. I do appreciate you sending me the ARC. I'm going to save up, especially now that I know that it's color, and get a real copy, I guess you might say. But it's incredible. Before I forget, you want to tell a story about...
Oh, yes. Well, so I told this story at the Lovecraft Film Fest. The annotated Sherlock Holmes. I did an event at the Newberry Library, underline the word library, about Sherlock Holmes and Conan Doyle and the like. And a woman came up to me after the talk and said, "I'm so glad I came. I'm a huge Sherlock Holmes fan, and I didn't know there were books." So, similarly, there are people who only know Lovecraft through the role-playing games or the films. And I think it's our mission to remind them that there are actual books.
Yeah. And by the way, for everyone watching, if you want to ask Leslie a question, I think pretty much everyone watching by now is familiar with the message board. I'll keep an eye on the message board, and I'll ask Leslie any questions that you guys post in there. If you're not familiar, it's on Facebook. You just have to go type in to the Facebook search bar at the top, Lovecraft eZine public message board, and I'll add you. So I'm lucky because I have this panel here, but today especially Rick and Pete are just really, they've got the kind of minds that love all these details. So I'm lucky to have them here because I know Rick is just raring to ask you some questions. I'm going to let him go for a minute here.
Okay. Well, I'm just going to address a general question that was raised on this show in a prior chat. In your introduction, you mentioned that you had to exclude some stories for reasons of space.
And, there's always going to be criticism of what I pick to exclude and what I pick to include, and that just goes with the territory, and so I'll just roll with it. But the reason for the exclusions was not a judgment on the quality of the stories, of course. It was a matter of size. The book is 860 pages. To have more stories would have meant a higher price, and we felt that that would detract from the audience for the book. So some things had to go. Unfortunately, I decided to cut the shunned house, the terrible old man, other gods, rats in the wall, the outsider, not because of quality, but because I decided to stick with sort of as the unifying principle, if you will, the mythos. We can debate the mythos, but the stories that were the foundations for the mythos, where we see the elder gods being introduced, sort of regardless of quality. So, for example, Beyond the Walls of Sleep is included because I think it's an important story. It was really Lovecraft's first attempt at this idea of mind transfer. I like the elements of the story where he works in actual science, and then there's the strange science of the radio that picks up thoughts. But I'm not going to apologize for what was left out. It's unfortunate that anything had to be left out, but it did.
Well, actually, I don't disagree personally at all. I think it's wise to focus on the, like you say, the more mythos stories. And besides, you've got my favorites in there, so that's what's really important. If it sells well, or I assume it is, would you consider a volume two, or is that out of the question? Or?
I think that's not going to happen. We put the most popular stories in the book, possibly with the exception of Rats in the Wall or The Outsider. There's not enough material to do another volume, really, and it's just not the way Norton's working. My next book is The Annotated Frankenstein. That'll come out in 2 years.
Oh.
So, 3 years, actually.
Cool. When did you say that would come out?
It's going to be out in the fall of 2017, sort of just in time for the 200th anniversary of the book.
Right. You've done Dracula, Frankenstein, and Sherlock Holmes.
The icons, Rick. By the way, Rick, you are the same Rick Lay who has written some wonderful Sherlock Holmes pastiche, are you not?
Yes.
The famous Rick Lay.
Good grief, somebody, finally a guest who's read my work.
You're in a footnote the Dying Detective, I think, where you had some speculations on, I think that's the story, I'm not
yeah,
sure.
Victor Stabbit.
Yes.
Thank you.
So see, Rick, you're in a footnote and you don't even know it.
I
have to buy the volume of his annotated Sherlock Holmes with that footnote now.
Well, it's a two-volume set for the short stories, so you got to buy both volumes if you want them in a nice slipcase. So.
Okay.
And you can justify that. You can tell the wife this is important work because it proves how famous you are.
There you are.
You're as famous as Sherlock Holmes now.
Hey, Les, I'm going to let Rick ask some more questions in a minute, but I do want to ask you this. What was some of your main goals when you set out to create this? What did you have in mind as what was most important?
I certainly didn't see it as my job to prove that Lovecraft was a great writer. I think that's already there. I did want to try and bring him, excuse the expression, more into the mainstream, in the sense that in the same sense that the Library of America edition exists, the Norton Annotated Library, which is now, I think, up to 18 titles, are classics of literature and world literature. And Lovecraft, to me, belongs in that pantheon. So that was one element of it. Second, I must say, though, I very much admire and am deeply grateful to S.T. Joshi for his work and his help specifically on this book. His annotated books, and there are two paperbacks and one, I think, one standalone, don't cover very many of the stories. They only cover 10 or 11 stories. And with all due respect, I won't even say it in that way because it sounds critical, ST's annotations are all basically original annotations. That is, they're STs, thoughts, opinions, analysis of the stories. Mm-hmm. There is other scholarship, as you well know. Right. And I felt that I wanted to try and be more inclusive in my notes to show the wide range of scholarship that has grown about the Lovecraft stories. And then finally, I wanted to do a book of pictures. I mean, you know, to put it really simply.
There's a lot of those, and, you know, we love them, too. It's great. And documents. Go ahead, Joe.
And you're to be commended for showing the range of scholarship.
Uh-oh, Joe froze.
Amazing job over the years with Lovecraft, and it's to be commended for it. But
thank you. Well, it was actually a lot of fun because I ended up acquiring a complete run of Crypt of Cthulhu and a complete run of Lovecraft Studies, as well as, you can see, a few books.
Those are supposed to be reprinted, but I don't know what happened with those.
I don't know what the status of those is myself currently.
It would also take a long while to reprint Crypt of Cthulhu. Yeah.
Well, I actually talked to a couple people about doing, in the Sherlock Holmes world, we finally bit the bullet, actually about 10 or 11 years ago now, and did a CD-ROM, now it's a DVD-ROM, of the complete run of the Baker Street Journal. That was just updated last year to pick up 10 more years.
Oh, I've got it.
The Baker Street Journal, you know, I mean, it's very expensive and time-consuming to try and acquire those issues. And they're wonderful. They go back to 1946. Crypt of Cthulhu would be relatively straightforward to do a DVD-ROM to collect them all. And the same with Lovecraft Studies.
Well, Crypt of Cthulhu is online for the most part. I don't believe absolutely everything, but most of the stories and articles.
I think it's really only later issues.
Is it?
Yeah, later. Yeah, not the early stuff.
It's only a small percentage of the stories.
I'm going to talk to Bob again about it, because I know that someone, I won't mention any names, was going to republish all of these, bundle them together, so to speak. And
he was going to do them in sections.
You know, this is the kind of stuff that the fans love less. First page of the manuscript of the case of Charles Dexter Ward. You know, things like that. Speaking of pictures and scans of documents, this is just incredible.
That's in many respects the best part of doing these annotated books has been always the assembly of the images. Sherlock Holmes, for example, there's over 1,000 images in that book. Dracula was about 350 images, and this is about 350 images. Many of them, by the way, you'll see as you look through it, are photographs by Donovan Laux and by the Californian Will Hart of Lovecraftian sites and places. While many of the photographs are online, Donovan retook a number of them to get higher resolution so we could use them in the book.
Well, that was very helpful. Rick, you got some more questions for Les?
Yes, you had one thing in this book that I've never seen before. You had a list of everybody at Miskatonic University in the back of the book.
Well, you know, it's there for just in case. I mean, if you're considering enrolling, you'd want to know some of the more prominent professors who have taught there. I mean, that's how universities are judged, right?
That's right.
Right, and I mean, I think that was excellent. I loved all the appendixes in this book.
Well, you know, the Sherlockian background is not for everyone, but I must say that Lovecraft himself said that a great horror story has to be written like a hoax, meaning that it has to be 99% realistic, only 1% supernatural. Mm-hmm. And so for an annotator, that's wonderful. And you know, they all played, he and his friends all played in the shared universe that they'd created. And so I like that. I mean, I'm not going to pretend that those people really lived, unlike Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson, who did really live.
Sure.
I think a certain element of spinning out the hoax, if you will, heightens the enjoyment of the stories.
Yeah, I agree.
I agree.
By the way, and Rick, you may already know this, and there's a long footnote about this somewhere in the book. Lovecraft himself was a great fan of Sherlock Holmes.
Yes.
He had his own little Sherlock Holmes club, where, of course, he was Holmes, and other people were lesser titles. But
now, you edited some anthologies as well, In the Shadow of Sherlock Holmes and The Shadow of Dracula.
Yes.
Are you planning to edit any more anthologies?
Yes, actually, Pegasus is going to bring out next year one called In the Shadow of Edgar Allan Poe, which will be classic 19th century horror.
Great.
I noticed your email address last time. Are you an attorney, or is this what
yes.
you do for a living?
Yes.
Okay.
No, those of us who write nonfiction books really have no hope of movie deals. and so I need a lucrative day job to pay for the expensive hobby of being a writer.
Well, most of us writers and editors don't make much money at it anyway. So I noticed that I saw that Neil Gaiman, and of course you have an introduction by Alan Moore. They're both very excited about this book. How do you know these guys, and how did they get?
Neil, I met originally through Sherlock Holmes' world. We were seated together at a dinner of the Baker Street Irregulars, his first time attending, and I was sort of nominated to be his informal guide for the evening. We became friends. He helped me with some aspects of the original Sherlock Holmes book. Eventually, I became his lawyer, but that's sort of unrelated. We had we did some projects together. He wrote the introduction for Dracula for me. We had always joked about doing an annotated Sandman, and then one day he called me up and said, "You know, I'm forgetting why I wrote what I wrote. We should do this." He called DC, and the result was that we just published Volume 3 of the Annotated Sandman. And I actually, through Neil, met Leah Moore, Alan's daughter, and her husband John Repian, who are wonderful comic book writers, and they are Sherlockians and Dracula fans. They've done a great comic called The Complete Dracula. They've done two comics on Sherlock Holmes, and I was a, quote, consultant for them on those books, and we became friends. And when I was casting around for the who would do the introduction for this book, top of my list was Alan Moore, because I knew that he is doing his own book called something like Providence 1917 or something like that, which is a young Lovecraft or younger Lovecraft having some adventures there. That's coming. I don't know when that's coming out, but it's soon.
He was deep in Lovecraft.
So I emailed Leah and said to her, "How do I put in front of your dad a proposal that he write this introduction? Because he doesn't do email." And 8 hours later, she's in England. 8 hours later, she emailed me back and said, "He'd love to do it." And I said, "Well, Leah, I didn't mean for you to ask him. I just wanted to, you know what the best way was he wanted to do it." So that was great.
Yeah, great.
I was thrilled.
Sounds like you owe these friendships in large part to Mr. Sherlock Holmes.
Well, yes, I've met so many wonderful writers and people in the publishing business through Sherlock Holmes originally, and then, yeah, I mean, there's a tremendous amount, as you guys all know, there is a tremendous amount of crossover of interest among these, what shall we call them, genre writers, you know, when you're in for a penny, you're in for a pound with all this stuff, I guess, you know, or a geek in one circle is a geek in many circles.
Yep. We've had a debate at times over whether Sherlock Holmes should be drawn into the Cthulhu mythos.
Well, you know, there's been a couple of stories where that has been done. The best of them, I think, being by Neil Gaiman, his wonderful story called A Study in Emerald. But it was also a computer game. The first, what's it called? Sherlock Holmes, The Awakening, I think.
The Awakening, I believe. And there's an anthology, and Neil's story is in that as well.
Yes.
Shadows Over Baker Street.
Right. And Titan Books asked me if I would edit another anthology of Holmes / Lovecraft stories, and I wasn't too excited about it. It's been done.
Yeah.
So I said maybe.
Was it Robert Vaughn who did the 3 or 4 chapbooks?
Yes.
Yeah, the dreaming.
But the reason why I have a debate. I think you could work in the mythos with Holmes, but you can't let the mythos overwhelm Holmes. And the problem with a lot of the stories in Shadow Over Baker Street is all of a sudden Holmes is becoming Lavin Shrewsbury and picking up the Necronomicon and reading things.
Yeah, I think for it to be successful, it has to be something that he encounters very infrequently. You know, might be a better story. I mean, I think there's a lot of interest in putting those, you know, Holmes and Lovecraft together, but, you know.
I think it's a great vehicle, and it's easily done and done properly. Think of Stone Cold Fever, Mike. It winds up to be a really Lovecraftian tale, and yet you have just one minor, one-sentence reference to Lovecraft.
You know, we don't have those Sherlock Holmes copyright problems anymore, do we, Pete?
Well, that's, I think Leslie solved a lot of that for us and had it laid out very, very specifically where we can and cannot use.
You want to talk about that a little bit? Because I don't know anything about that.
Sure. I'm happy to talk about it. And tomorrow, by the way, is I'm hoping, a very big day for reasons I'll explain in a second. So,
I'm sorry, Les, could you repeat that? You froze for a second.
I said that tomorrow is a big day for reasons that I'll explain in a second.
Okay.
So, Laurie King and I decided about 3 years ago, to put together an anthology of new stories by friends of ours in the mystery world, largely, inspired by Sherlock Holmes. This was called A Study in Sherlock. It was published by Random House. Just before the book came out, we were contacted by the Conan Doyle estate, who said, you need a license to use the character of Sherlock Holmes. We said, no, we don't. There are 50 stories in the public domain. Why would we need a license to use the characters?
Right.
Nonetheless, Random House decided that it would be too expensive to fight about it, and so they paid a license fee, and that was the end of that. In 2012, we decided to do another anthology, just like the first one, with Pegasus Books, and we were moving along smartly until the estate once again said, you need a license. This time, Pegasus said, look, I can't even publish the book without you taking care of this problem. Laurie and I talked it over, and in February of 2013, we filed a lawsuit asking for declaratory relief to determine that we were free to use the characters of Holmes and Watson without obtaining a license. In December of 2013, the District Court of Northern Illinois, the Federal District Court of the Northern District of Illinois, that's where the estate's offices were, ruled in our favor and said that as long as we were not using elements of the character that appeared only in the 10 copyrighted stories, there are 10 stories that remain in copyright until 2017 through 2022, when they'll lapse into the public domain, that we were fine to use the elements that appeared in the 50 stories, meaning, of course, the names of Holmes, Watson, Moriarty, Mrs. Hudson, the pipe, the deer stalker, the magnifying glass,
right,
all those things.
Right.
The estate appealed. It went to the Seventh Circuit. In June of this year, the Seventh Circuit, in a scathing opinion, roasted the Conan Doyle estate, called them extortionists, and ruled in our favor. The estate undaunted, filed what's called a petition for certiorari with the U.S. Supreme Court. That is a petition that asks the Supreme Court to take the case. In fact, the Supreme Court takes very few cases. 90% of the cases that come that are put before them, they turn down. The ruling on the petition for certiorari will come out tomorrow morning.
Oh, okay. Is that going to be pretty much what you expect, you think?
We don't know. Everybody tells me, of course, the court is going to turn down this case, and that'll be the end of it, and we will have won. But, you know, I'll feel better when I see it.
Once it happens, yeah.
Yes.
Now, would they be turning down that case as on the basis of precedence, or...?
In order to take a case, the court has to be convinced that it's something that requires the Supreme Court to intervene, meaning that there is either a, quote, substantial federal question or a conflict among the circuits. That is, that in this case, the Seventh Circuit opinion contradicts an opinion by other courts. We think neither of those conditions really apply here, and so the court is not going to take this case. They have many more important things to worry about than this. Yeah. There is no conflict really with the circuit among the circuits, and I think the court will let the very well-reasoned opinion of the Seventh Circuit stand.
So, do you think that this, by so doing, that would be setting a precedent for future?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, the court laid out in some detail, and by the way, I mean, this doesn't just apply to Sherlock Holmes. There are some other characters, you'll be happy to hear, that are similarly situated. For example, Zorro, Edgar Rice Burroughs' Tarzan, John Carter. I think Hercule Poirot is also in this situation. And the situation is that there are stories that appeared prior to 1923 with the characters in those stories, which means that those stories are public domain. If you confine yourself to elements that appear in the public domain stories, the Seventh Circuit says you are fine. You do not need to obtain a license from the holders of the copyrights of the later stories.
There's that John Carter story you've always wanted to write, Joe.
I confess... John Carter started my love affair with Mars, but it's Lee Brackett.
Well, and keep in mind, by the way, Joe, because I think this affects you, we're only talking about a U.S. copyright issue. Yeah, Sherlock Holmes, for example, is in the public domain everywhere else in the world, and even in, because elsewhere in the world, they have followed the more rational rule of copyright duration being 70 years after the death of the author. The U.S. has now switched to that, but that's recent.
Hmm. Well, all my stuff comes out in the U.S. I just live here, that's all.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I have a question from the audience, Les. Kim says, do you have a particular story that you wish you could have included in the book, and you've stated your reasons previously, but could not for whatever reason? In other words, is there a favorite that, you know, if you'd had been able to...
I'm not sure. I mean, of course, but... So Terrible Old Man and the Old Gods were actually both in an earlier version of the book and had to be literally cut. I never got around to annotating The Shunned House or Rats in the Wall or The Outsider because I knew that they just weren't going to fit. But the first two stories I actually had annotated and had to drop them because we just didn't have the room.
Now, are you a big Lovecraft fan, or is this something fairly recent for you? I've heard it was somewhat recent.
It is recent, and I feel... I should explain my own reading habits. I started reading probably at the age of 5 or 6, and reading whatever I could read then. And by the age of 8, I was deep into science fiction. I must have read, by the time I was in law school, had read thousands. I mean, certainly more than 1,000 science fiction novels, subscribed to Galaxy, subscribed to the Magazine of Fantasy and Science Fiction and all that. So I had heard of Lovecraft. I had heard of Sherlock Holmes. but I hadn't really paid any attention to either of them. That was old stuff. I wanted to read new stuff. Mm. So I didn't read Sherlock Holmes till I was in law school, and I got hooked there by the annotated, by Baring Gould's annotated Sherlock Holmes. Lovecraft, I started reading only a few years ago, really when I decided to do this project. I certainly knew who he was and knew how influential he had been, but other than probably reading somewhere along the line, the Dunwich Horror, maybe Call of Cthulhu, I didn't really have any particular interest in Lovecraft or knew much about the stories. Yeah, so this so was an immersion process.
There's just so much out there to read, you know.
Yes.
I have a question, because you just mentioned something. You said you had a couple of things that you had finished, but due to, you know, page constraint, word count, you had to omit. Is there any chance you would release them, not as another book, but as single units, as e-books, or...
No, Joe, I hadn't even thought about it. I certainly will take a look at them, and I may just put them up on my website for free. I mean,
because word on the street is so positive about this.
Yeah.
And the one negative is, oh, too bad he didn't do this. Oh, I wish he'd done that. Once people get their hands on this and realize that this guy did this incredible work, and there's a couple of pieces that are done, but they're not available, I think there'll be a hunger there.
Well, thanks for the suggestion. I look at those and see, and who knows, maybe in my spare time, which I'm trying to find, my wife wonders when that is, I might go back and annotate some of the ones like The Outsider that I really didn't have a chance to do.
Like I said, you know, there are so many Lovecraftian collectors and completists knowing... Once they encounter your work and fall for it the way, like, Rick has.
Well, thank you. That's very kind, Joe. It's an interesting idea, one that I hadn't thought about, and, you know, there's no reason why. I certainly could publish it as an e-book. You're absolutely right.
That's all right. I'll send you my address where to send the, you know, consult.
The commission.
Yeah. Well, do you have a particularly favorite Lovecraft story?
I think two favorites. I'm going to cheat. Charles Dexter Ward and Mountains of Madness. Fundamentally for the same reason, which is the detail. Dexter Ward is so meticulously researched, and it's just this great story that, to me, builds in a very similar way to similar way to Dracula. Slowly you start to realize that there's something really horrific going on here, and I just think it's a masterwork. And at the Mountains of Madness, I love that it reads like almost like an academic report. For a while, anyway, and until you get sucked in, and so I just love those two stories, the detail in those, you know. But every one of these stories is just a gem. So
did your appreciation of any of the stories alter before? I mean, once you had gotten into it and finished your annotations, was there any story that went from, I used to think this was pretty good, and now I love, or I used to love it, but it, you know, any of your appreciations shift at all in the process?
Well, I think yes. I mean, I think Dexter Ward, really, it was a shift, because Dexter Ward, it was a matter of going, oh my God, look at the quantity of research and the care that Lovecraft took with the story. So, yes, my appreciation there really did change. But there wasn't any story where I said, oh, this isn't a very good story, and now suddenly I thought it was a very good story. I won't say that. So,
Pete, you've been kind of quiet. You're...
Oh, I'm just...
You have some questions? I don't want to ignore you.
As I said offline before we started, I if this book had been put out 5 years before, I would half my work would have been done for me. I wouldn't have had to read At the Mountains of Madness 5 or 6 times to try and pick up what each character was capable of doing, the expedition list. I mean, if those people who have read my work know that I've been very detail-oriented, and there's very little Lovecraft scholarship on those kind of details. This book solves that problem.
Well, it takes an obsessive, Pete. I don't know what else to say. I mean, you're right. There hasn't been obsessive attention to the details until an obsessive like me and you did it.
You visit a Lovecraft forum online, you know, I'm interested in cosmic horror and so forth. You know, I'm friends with Sandy Peterson, and, you know, I'll be over at his house and we talk about Lovecraft monsters, and he's like, well, you know that this has a thought, this, and I'm like, no, I don't know. I don't remember that stuff. And he's like, they've got all this in their brains, and they love discussing it. They love talking about it. They love going over every little detail.
That's me and Pete in a nutshell.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that.
That's why they wrote this book.
It's kind of like the guys, you know, who are baseball stat freaks. I was never one, but I can appreciate that. I understand it.
Yeah, and I get that. I mean, you talked about At the Mountains of Madness. I've written 4 sequels to At the Mountains of Madness now. One of them, a parallel story from Gedney's point of view. So that, right. And it reads almost exactly, it's very similar, it's a different voice, but it's telling the same story from a different point of view. Because if you go on scientific expeditions like Niels and I have gone, you know that there's never agreement on everything. And grad students see things differently than major professors do. And, you know, so I think there's a lot of space in At the Mountains of Madness for a reinterpretation of that story. In the case of Charles Dexter Ward, it's funny that you talk about it you mentioned Dracula earlier, and in rereading that, I keep thinking that it's a rewrite of Dracula, that maybe he's inspired by what he's read or the movie. I'm not sure. But I've looked at a lot of Lovecraft work recently through that glass, and I see a lot of parallels between Lovecraft's work and popular fiction of the day. And I've been trying to think about how that might fit together. Herbert West is, in my mind, a rewrite of Frankenstein.
Yeah, no way.
And, you know, a lot of people say, you know, Lovecraft never wrote vampire fiction. Well, the case of Charles Dexter Ward all revolves around blood drinking.
Well, and in fact, actually, there are vampires that appear in the story. At least there's a thought vampires are involved.
Yeah, you know, there's a reference in there to an epidemic or some outbreak of vampirism
Right. So, you know, there are parallels between the popular fiction of that day and what Lovecraft's writing. I'm very interested in that, and I think that this might go. What you've done here is absolutely incredible. I've really enjoyed it. You caught the thing about the in Charles Dexter Ward about the Qanun al-Islam being a real book, but not possibly being in Kerwin's library, because it's not published for 200 years later. It's an old book.
Right.
Lovecraft, but it's not old enough to be in colonial times.
Right.
So that's kind of cool. There's a lot of stuff in here that I thought that I and a few other people were the only ones who figured this stuff out.
Some of it is not. I mean, I'm not going to claim that I discovered many original things. I mean, of course, some of this is I have carefully combed tons and tons of other people's scholarship to pick up these little nuggets in many cases.
And you know, only if you have Volume 3 of Issue 6 of Crypt of Cthulhu, do you have an article? And, yeah, you know, I've got 75% of the collection, so I've read a lot of it. And yeah, it's just a great synthesis of scholarship that's been spread out over that's not widely read. I think you've done a magnificent job here.
Thank you.
Again, for those who are watching either now or later, if you're watching on YouTube, I've got a link to the book in the comments right below the video. And if you're watching on the site, I posted about this yesterday, and I've got a link to the book there. It's available in print and Kindle, which is great, the Kindle being searchable.
So after...
Rick or Pete or anybody, we got more questions for Les?
Yeah, I got one question. So we after rushing all over the book, I have a question for you. Have you become a fan of the fiction, and are you moving beyond Lovecraft at all?
I think the short answer is no.
That's fine.
I by the way, I mean, it's not limited. Notwithstanding my comments to Rick earlier, I know of his stories, and I've read a couple of them, but I really read very little Sherlockian pastiche as well. It doesn't interest me. I have too many other things to read. And so I know that there are some wonderful writers out there who have been deeply influenced by Lovecraft, and I do read some other authors in the genre. I just finished Peter Straub's In the Night Room, have read his Mr. X and so on, and I read all Gaiman stuff and so on. But no, I am not as somebody who has indulged in a lot of the mythos of writing.
You still read a lot of science fiction?
Yes, and now mysteries, only because I have so many friends in the mystery community, I feel like I should be reading their books. It's very hard to keep up.
Yeah, it seems to me that science fiction, more than any other genre, and I'm a fan of a lot of mysteries, of obviously Lovecraftian fiction. Science fiction, you get this sense of wonder in really good science fiction that you don't in some other genres. You know, it's one of my...
Absolutely. And I must say, by the way, as a further example of what I said about my coming late to the party with Lovecraft, I just read the first three John Carter books. They just totally escaped me when I was reading science fiction as a kid, because they were old. I wanted to read Heinlein and Asimov and James Gunn and Avram Davidson and Richard Matheson and all the guys who were currently writing.
Yeah. Well, I was in my early 20s before I discovered Lovecraft at all. So, and I was a voracious reader since 5 or 6, like you. So just didn't happen.
Right. It should have happened. You go back through. I see Bradbury on your shelf behind you. You know, yeah. Bradbury leads you back to Lovecraft, and certainly many other science fiction writers do. But you know, what can I say? I was ignorant.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Like I said, there's a lot of choices, a lot of things to read.
I've been trying to make up for it.
Rick, any more questions for Les?
Yeah, you do some wonderful work, Les, with architecture and art. You have every building that Lovecraft mentions an excellent picture of, and anytime he mentions an artist, you find the perfect painting to reflect his works.
Well, I've tried. Thank you. It's Lovecraft appreciated those details, so I want to share that stuff with the readers. I always think of my footnotes and these books as kind of like the bonus tracks on the DVDs. You know, you don't want to read them first. You don't want to look at the notes first. You want to read the story first and appreciate it. But the second time through, hopefully you read the notes and you say, yeah, that's really good. I missed that part first time through.
Yeah.
Do you ever go back and revise your annotations or add more to them?
Well, so I just added one that will appear in the second printing. I've forgotten who already. This is what happened with Sherlock Holmes. I'll tell you this, and I was mortified in the beginning, and then I learned to live with it. When the book came out, I started getting emails saying, "Dear Mr. Klinger, love the book. Fabulous, wonderful, terrific book, and on page 438, note 7, you have a mistake."
But you messed up here.
Right. And I was just mortified by this. It was like, how could I have errors? And then I started thinking about the quantity of notes and the quantity of facts in those notes and realized that my batting average was like 998 or something. Right. So I was doing pretty well, and I started putting the errata up on my website. So far with Lovecraft, I've only gotten two of those emails. One of them is going to be a new note about an interesting topic, and that is the word snow that appears in Charles Dexter Ward, and it has been corrected in most additions to the word scow, S-C-O-W, instead of the word snow, S-N-O-W. In fact, snow is correct. It was an 18th century term for a certain kind of sailing vessel, and I made the change to scow, and now I'm changing it back and putting in a new footnote. So, you know, that'll be in the second printing. God willing, there is one.
Well, we'll have one. We'll have another one for you soon.
Good.
Yeah, because Pete's going to buy so many copies because he'll burn through these. Mm-hmm. He'll force the second printing all by himself.
No. Actually, I think he's done some great as you've rated a lot of other research, and one of the things that a friend of mine and I are working on is a in the Dreams in the Witch House. Gilman is from I'm sorry, I'm going to get it right here because I always say Haverhill, but it's really Haverhill. That's
Haverhill.
Haverhill, yes.
Haverhill.
1926, a year after the story is set, there is a plague outbreak of rat bite fever.
Wonderful.
Yeah, which apparently is still in the minds when Lovecraft is writing this story. It's a nice tie-in to what's going on in this mind, this brain fever that Gilman has all through the book. We're writing that up now.
Well, great. So there aren't going to be. There's a limited opportunity to add new material. Let me put it that way. It's difficult to add extensive new material, but certainly corrections are welcomed, and short new material can sometimes work in. Now, in the case of Sherlock Holmes, we were able to make small corrections in the second and third printings. When we got to the ebook, it suddenly became we could do all the corrections. So that was great. So we may be able to correct the ebook edition of Lovecraft sooner than we can correct or expand the ebook edition sooner than we can expand the printings. I don't know whether there'll be a second printing. First printing was, I think, 15,000 copies, so we got to get going.
I was going to ask, are you doing well? Are you doing okay?
Doing very well. I couldn't be happier. You know, at this point, there's no real feedback from bookstores, so all I can really go by is Amazon sales rank, but that has been consistently in the top 1,000 or lower or higher, I guess, since the book came out. So that's great. That's really good. And the bookstores are all very enthusiastic. Barnes & Noble has been doing a wonderful job of selling the book. I've tried to go to a number of independents as well, and still not finished with touring. Next week I'm in Minneapolis, Seattle, and where I'm going to do an event with SD, and Portland. The week after that I'm in Phoenix, and I'm also working in an event next week with as Del Howison at Dark Horror put it. He was so happy to see I was trying to help out younger writers. Doing an event with Neil Gaiman.
Okay. When does the movie come out? The annotated H.P. Lovecraft movie come out? Is that soon?
Hey, look, the rights are available, Mike. Just make us an offer.
All right. Any more questions for Les? Are we done harassing him, or?
By the way, I want to say a word about Providence. Two things about Providence. One is that I think there are going to be some events in around the anniversary of Lovecraft's death. I'm going to be appearing in Providence for such an event. I think it's the Saturday right around Lovecraft's death. And then, of course, Niels is going to talk about the Necronomicon, which will be in August in Providence. So Providence will once again be a hot hotbed of Lovecraftian activities.
Will you be going to Necronomicon?
I will. Niels has been very kind to invite me as a guest of honor, and I am really honored to go. I went to the last one, and it was great, and I was really affected by how the Lovecraftians embraced a newbie like me, and it was a terrific event, so I can't wait to go back.
Well, newbie or not, you know, we appreciate the fantastic job that you've done with this book. I mean, how seriously you've taken our obsession here, you know, and done such a great job with all these details. So it really is a wonderful, wonderful book. So
thanks, Mike.
Well, thanks for being on the show. We're going to talk to Niels. You're welcome to stay or go. I think you said you had an appointment, but
I do have another appointment, so I got to run. But thanks so much for having me on, and I look forward to seeing more of the eZine and seeing you guys in Providence next year.
I will be there. I look forward to seeing you.
We'll see you in March, too, Les. We'll see you in March. Yes. Take care.
Thanks, Niels. Bye. Take care.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot.
All you got to do is X out your window there. There you go. Hey, Niels.
Hey there. How are you guys doing?
Good. How's it been going?
It's crazy. It's a little busy. A little busy. But a little behind on some writing tasks. What Pete was alluding to earlier for doing scientific reports.
But, yeah. So for the audience watching, if you don't know who Niels Hobbs is, Niels is the mad genius behind Necronomicon, the Lovecraftian convention in Providence every 2 years. So Niels is in charge of that. You want to talk a little bit about it? What do we know so far, Niels?
I guess, I'm trying to think, it's been a while actually since I've been on the eZine. Right now things are steamrolling ahead. I mean, we're in the single digit months until it happens, which is kind of frightening to consider. I think we pretty much nailed down most of the venues. All the primary venue spaces are all booked. I think we're pretty much set with who we've asked for our special guests. I think probably a few of you have just received surveys from us asking about what kind of panels you'd be interested in and what you'd like to see more of.
Can you talk about your special guest yet, or is that under wraps?
The special guest. We are waiting to make the official announcement. Some of the names we've already announced, like Ramsey Campbell, Leslie Klinger, Ann Schwader is going to be our poet laureate for this year, or for this coming year.
That's awesome.
And a few other really great artists and academics and writers. I think we're really excited about how many. We might have added on a few too many, but it's, you know, obviously it's very hard to say who do you ask and who don't you ask when there's so many amazing people that contribute so much to weird fiction, weird art, and the sort of academic side of that as well. But
What are the dates again?
The dates are August. The primary dates of the convention are August 20th to the 23rd. So it's starting on Lovecraft's birthday, and it's his 125th birthday. So it's a very big, obviously auspicious calendar date, and the city of Providence is pretty excited about that too. They're buying into our hope of making essentially the entire month sort of the month of Lovecraft in Providence. So it's quite a number of things being planned.
I'm glad to see the last year or so they've gotten on board, you know, so to speak. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think you have a lot to do with that.
I mean, a very successful convention. The fact that we didn't burn Providence to the ground, and you know, it was nothing but positive things that happened. I think, you know, made the city take note for sure.
Well, Pulver tried, but he was restrained.
I was well behaved.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay.
Pete, not so much. Pete,
I have to relate something to you because you mentioned we didn't burn Providence to the ground. I was guest at a convention recently, and I'm not going to name names, where I had to sign a form saying I wouldn't violate state, federal, local laws and policies about being naked or burning stuff. I found it really, I don't know, not quite offensive, but kind of
Well, Niels is so trusting. He doesn't make you sign stuff.
Well, I don't know about
trusting. I need to talk to my lawyer.
I was well-behaved, but I wasn't allowed off the leash either.
Yeah.
Well, you were a newly married man while you were there, so...
That's true.
Well, for the first half, he wasn't even that.
That's true. Oh, that's true. But anyway, but things are looking great, and we've already gotten. So we sent out a survey yesterday to the guests that were with us last year. I think it went out to about 100 different people or so, and within 16 hours, we'd already heard back from almost half of those people, and every single one of them, except for only three so far, have said they couldn't make it again. All of them were incredibly positive about the experience they had and just couldn't wait to be part of it again. So that's
I'll get to mine in the next couple of days here.
Yeah. No worries. That wasn't meant as a guilt trip at all.
No, I know. I'm glad you're...
When I hear one, I've been married 5 times.
Can you talk about any events? Is anything lined up, talks, anything like that can you talk about yet, or is it too early?
Some of that's a little too early. I mean, so we're still in the planning stages for, you know, what kind of panels there are. Obviously, we can't just rehash what we did last time.
Right.
Some of the topics, I think, from last time clearly deserve revisiting, but there's so many things to talk about in sort of the weird fiction field that there's certainly no shortage either of new things to talk about. And that's one of the things, I think our theme for next year, especially for Lovecraft's 125th birthday, is we really want to expand it to make it much more of an international discussion, and that includes incorporating people from Central and South America who make a huge portion of Lovecraft's fan base, and also we want to include a lot more of authors that are associated with Lovecraft, so include more about Clark Ashton Smith and William Hope Hodgson and stuff like that, and make it much more of a community discussion in every way, shape, and form.
That sounds great. Awesome. Well, I can't wait. I'm sorry, August 20th through the 23rd, is that what you said?
Yeah, those are the 4 days of the convention, and then all the week before there will be stuff every day going on, and then, you know, essentially for the month before as well, there'll be quite a bit too. So we're really hoping we can get even more people to come in for the full week beforehand, especially that way it gives them time to explore a lot more Providence, see the art shows that we're going to be having going on at the same time. There'll be film screenings going on too.
You guys did a kind of Lovecraftian tour of Providence last time, or was that just us two, or did other people do it too?
Donovan Laux, not surprising, Donovan Laux organized a whole team of really talented Lovecraftians to take tours around, walking tours around Providence. Yeah. So I think he had like 5 or 6 people, obviously including ST, but like Daryl Schweitzer was doing it. Can't remember right now offhand who the other people were, but there was a number of great walking tours that were led by folks from the community.
Will you repeat that?
Yep. Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. That was one of the comments, was that and more so. And I think we're also going to incorporate some bus tours as well to go to some of the farther sites, like obviously up to Swan Point Cemetery, and some of the Lovecraft sites that are a little bit farther away, a little out of walking distance.
And it's kind of hilly, too.
Yeah, some people notice that Providence is a little bit hilly.
Necronomicon last year, I was kind of handicapped.
Yeah, you were.
It's not just that it's hilly, it's that they're cobblestones, and the sidewalks are all canted. So you have to walk. If you have a cast or something on, you're walking, and you're already tilted, and then all of a sudden you're like at a 45-degree angle. And then the cobblestones are just... But it was fun. I lived in fear every minute, but it was fun.
Yeah.
How strict is the no nudity rule? Is that funny?
Providence is the capital of what's normally called Rogue Island, so we don't have those kind of blue laws whatsoever. I mean, essentially anything goes.
Okay, it's good to know.
If anyone from the city of Providence is listening, I'm completely lying about that.
We got anything else we want to ask Niels about Economicon or anything else?
Actually, Niels, you know, drop me an email. We're looking for, because we want to spend a lot more time there than we did last year. And we're looking for a realtor who worked with us for like a week rental or something.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. You find somebody, maybe post that on the website.
Yeah. So we do have, that's one thing I can tell you, a little bit of a tangent, but we our website is in the process of being updated. We've been working on it for a while, a completely new approach to it. And one of the things that's going to go up, ideally, I think next week, will be a full list of accommodations, including the two main hotels we'll be using, but also recommended other ways of getting places to stay, like Airbnb, for example, is a really good alternative.
Yeah, and for those of you who are watching, you want to get your accommodations in early because this is a really popular event.
Yeah.
And you know, there's other Lovecraft conventions, and they are awesome, but this is the big one, and it lives up to the hype. It's incredible. I had a great time last year.
So. Yeah, thank you, Mike. Well, it was certainly great having you guys, that's for sure. But
well, especially well organized, and everything went off from a guest standpoint without a hitch. You know, that's great. Such a large event.
I'm just amazed that your wife didn't divorce you.
Believe me, I'm sure if she'd had slightly more sense than she probably does. I didn't say that. I'm kidding. She would be would have, but no. Fortunately, she stuck it out and helped tremendously too. But the nice thing is, you know, we really learned a lot of bumps and bruises, lessons along the way from the last time. Mm-hmm. And I think the whole team here is really happy that those lessons are now going to make it so that we can actually enjoy next year a little bit more than we did last time. I personally am looking forward to not having to run around like a madman like I did last time and actually getting a chance to talk with Joe and Pete a little bit more. So.
Oh, we don't matter.
Again, you, your staff, all the minions from the guest standpoint, I've never had such pleasure in interaction.
There's a when I've gone to cons, there's been a lot of passing the buck, and
none of that.
The minions just worked out perfectly. Something came up, you assigned it to somebody, and they took care of it.
And you didn't, you know, you they would stop what they were doing and say, "Did you need something, Joe?" And it's like, "Oh, I just have a question. Take your time." No. I'm available to you right now. And they were. Things were resolved instantly.
Well, they were under strict instructions from Niels that if Joe Fulmer needed something,
it was the most fun I've ever had at an convention.
Thank you. That's great.
Everybody on the staff was absolutely marvelous. We're doing a Herculean job.
Yeah. I just one quick thing about that. But that actually is sort of 2 points about that. I think one, the team here was really lucky to have a great core team and to have just a remarkable collection of minions, essentially, the sort of the volunteers that helped out, who just were, absolutely every single one of them was just incredibly dedicated to wanting to do this fun thing in Providence. But that's only part of it. The other thing is that we had something like 1,300 guests or something like that total, and attendees. And that would have been fine. Having great minions and great staff is one thing, but having 12 or 1,300 attendees come who are incredibly awesome themselves and giving and supportive and patient speaks hugely more to the weird community more than anything else. It made our jobs that much easier. We had no big egos, nobody who was like freaking out because they couldn't get in somewhere or whatever. Even though there were certain things that we, wish that we could have done better last time, nobody complained about that. All the feedback we got with, maybe one exception, all the feedback we got was incredibly positive, and when it was critical, it was supportive and constructive criticism.
Neil, I have a question for you personally.
Yeah.
You know, this is a hell of a lot of work. I mean, I know it is a hell of a lot of work. I don't know if most people can even conceive of how much planning goes into this and work goes into this. What inspired you to want to do this again, to get Necronomicon going again?
To get it going from the original Necronomicons?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I moved to Providence in 1996, and the Necronomicons had already been going on for a couple of years prior to that. And I specifically moved here to Providence to go to school for marine biology because of my interest in Lovecraft.
That's
a completely awful, geeky thing to say. But that's at least 75% true. And almost immediately I got too busy with school that I never ever got to go to any of the Necronomicons. And every single time I'm like, oh, I'm going to do it this year, and I just never, ever could, because it was always when I was the busiest in the field. And then it didn't happen, and it didn't happen. And then friends of mine and I, who were all big fans of Lovecraft, started hearing about, you know, all the things going on around the world. Like, there was even a Lovecraft festival in Stockholm. And at that point, and there was, you know, the one that happened out in Arizona. And we were just like, wait a second, why aren't these happening here in Providence? You know, there's nothing wrong with Providence. Like, we should be having these here. So we just finally were like, we just got to do it. And then, stupidly, we started telling a few too many people that we wanted to do it, and then we were stuck. We had no choice but to go forward.
Well, you're right. That's definitely, if it's held nowhere else, it should be held there.
Well, I think it could be held all sorts of places, but absolutely it has to be held here, too.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah.
By the way, I think I've told you this, but you have my dream job. Biologist.
You don't speak until you try it.
Yeah, I knew you were going to say something like that, but it's just very interesting to me. It's probably less glamorous than it looks from the outside.
It's a lot less glamorous than it looks, but at the same time, I'm also pretty happy that
I had it. Niels, I'll relate an incident that will clear things up.
Yeah.
We had an incident this week. We had a new trainee who stuck her hand into a pile of detritus. And came up with something called a spider flea, a gator flea, which is a small amphipod, an insect about this big, that has a piercing, sucking mouth part.
God.
It's the worst pain you can ever feel in your life up until the time you have kidney stones. He came up with 10 of them.
Don't mention kidney stones to me, please.
Yeah. And, you know, her hand... She was screaming as these things tasted her. And yeah.
And what's this thing called again?
It's called a gator flea. It's
Is it actually a flea, or is it?
No, it's a hemipteran.
Oh, okay.
And they have these piercing, sucking mouth parts, and they usually stab plants or fish or mollusks, and they suck out a little fluid, and then they go on their merry way. They don't particularly like humans, but anything that touches them, they decide to taste. And it's just like getting hit with a number one gauge needle.
Yeah.
It's not a pleasant experience.
I got to just say that that's one of the things that, you know, this is sort of the standard question, I think, on the Lovecraft eZine. What is the thing that attracted you to Lovecraft? But for me, it's the fact that his depiction of weird creatures is remarkably parallel to the actual kind of creatures we really have on the planet. So, stories like Pete's, I think those are pretty commonplace. Various kind of blood-sucking critters.
All right, we sucked the life out of the room.
Yeah, that was it. Enough nerd talk, Pete. Way to go, man.
You should write a story, Pete, where those creatures are minions of the insects of Shagai.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I could do that. Yeah, sure. Okay, done. I was looking for an idea for a story. Thanks. I'll write that one down tonight.
Yeah, just whip that one out tonight. 20,000 words. Get it done.
Well, that'll take them all week. not tonight. All week. We have to give them to, like, Friday.
Well, we may want to make it part of a novel, though, in
Beat. Yeah.
Herbert West will reanimate them or whatever.
Yeah. Well, then maybe Herbert West uses them to acquire body fluids or something, you know. Yeah. What happened to Mike?
Dope, we lost Mike.
Oh no!
We're leaderless and adrift.
That means we can say anything we want and he won't know about.
This is when Pete gets naked and starts setting things on fire.
No, Pete's been good tonight. He doesn't even have any beer around.
Honestly, I was kind of like stunned that you would ask a guest to sign a clause like that.
Yeah. Honestly, like, you know, now having some experience with conventions under my belt, almost anything, nothing surprises me anymore.
Yeah, I get it.
And you know, I think it kind of underscores sort of some of the points of view for a lot of convention organizers, for example. This is an awful aside, but we just had Rhode Island Comic Con this past weekend.
I was reading about that in CNN.
Oh, no. Uh-oh, it's gotten that bad, has it?
Yeah.
Oh, no. Well, just for those of you who maybe aren't familiar or aren't aware of it, it has kind of become this huge cattle fest where it's just a matter of shoving as many people as they possibly can into a convention center with really little regard for, you know, comfort, for any sort of basic respect. And so people were not, you know, buying tickets and not being able to get in and all this kind of stuff and just a really poor treatment, I think, from the organizer's point of view. But
someone's touching me.
Yeah, right.
Mike, are you back?
We just see he's trying to get in, it looks like.
Yeah.
Let's not let him in. Joe, what's up with you? What's the latest with you? Are you working on any big projects right now? Joe? Dear God, is everyone dropping out?
Yes, you guys are freezing on me periodically. I'm hearing half a word here and half a word there. So, Google, it's one of those things where, you know, it's like Google wants to, you know, I don't know. I guess this is the trick part of Halloween, post-Halloween.
Wait, I just noticed that every single one of us, well, Joe, you're blocking out, Mike's gone now. Every single one of us are so nerdy that we have to have books for our background. I think next time I'm going to be on the Lovecraft eZine, I'm going to have, I don't know, like huge tropical plants or something growing over the top of me, just for something different. Yes. We should all make a pact that we have to have, like, big surprise backgrounds. You know, even if it's just, like, something you, like, pull down, like some tropical or like a Thomas Gainsborough landscape or something like
that. That's gonna prove interesting in this room. I mean, the nightmarium here is I can touch both walls without moving.
The joys of living in Berlin, huh?
Yeah. Eastern Europeans, you know. Everything is on a very small scale.
Isn't it pronounced Berlin?
Berlin.
Berlin.
But yes, Burr. You got to remember that it was getting near the last days of August, and there was one evening where we had to turn the heat on.
God.
It's been chilly.
Fortunately, we've only
We hear people. Mike, a couple of times Mike and I have Skyped, and, you know, he's got three ceiling fans roaring right overhead, and he's still dying. And it's like, you know, I'm getting ready to put on a sweater.
Do we know if we're still being taped?
I think we're live. Yeah.
It says
for
live.
Better or worse. For better.
It says live. Is anybody?
Mike's texting me. He's trying to get back in.
Yeah, okay. But is any